somebody. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody say praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We worship you. We thank y'all for coming with us today and worshiping God. I pray, come on, somebody, if you would raise up your hands right now, just begin to invite the Lord in this place. Lord, we invite you in. We worship you. We honor you this morning. Come on, somebody, he's here. Come on, somebody, let's worship just for a moment before we start. Come on, somebody, hallelujah. We worship you. We worship you. Come bless the Lord, come bless the Lord, draw near to worship Christ the Lord, and bless his name, his holy name, declaring his goodness. Come bless the Lord, come bless the Lord, draw near to worship Christ the Lord, and bless his name, his holy name, declaring his goodness. Oh, that men would praise him. Oh, that
rejoice in the Lord.
lift up a shout of praise unto God this morning. Hallelujah, we worship you. We worship you. Hallelujah, Jesus. We come here this morning to lift up your name. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah, we honor you. We praise you. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, if you would, slip up your hands. Just begin to worship. Just begin to worship our God. The Lord is my shepherd. Hallelujah, Jesus. Come on, somebody, let's worship. Let's create an atmosphere this morning. Let's make it easy for the Lord to move. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah.
The Lord is my shepherd.
He goes before me.
He goes before me.
Defender behind me.
Defender behind me. It gives me assurance.
So glad that you decided to come to the house of God today. We're so thankful to have all of our visitors here today. We've got some, I think, in every section. Thank you for waking up with Higher Praise Tabernacle on your mind. Yeah. You could have decided to go anywhere else. And this goes for everybody. You could have decided to go anywhere else, but you decided to come to the house of God, the place where there's strength, hope, help, and the refuge. Hallelujah. I tell you what, Pastor Merrill, these crowds are looking better and better. I
It certainly is a far cry from a Wednesday night, but hopefully we'll get back to that here shortly, hopefully. But thank you so much for allowing, giving yourself the opportunity to come and to enter into His presence this morning. God is so good. Well, Pastor Merrill preached a message last Sunday. Faith was high. PJ came home. Now, let me remind you, he had complications of COVID-19, which had him double pneumonia, blood clots, and C. diff. That's some bad stuff. But that's nothing compared to the power of God and to the power of prayer. All of the nurses that felt the presence of God in that room, isn't it just amazing to know that you serve a true and living God? A God of second chances. A God that is a healer, a miracle worker. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody. Aren't you glad you serve Him today? The only true and living God. Hallelujah. Well, we praise you, Jesus. We praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. It was also told to me that Jack Fuller, the one that was in ICU that had COVID, he came home. And let me just throw this out as a reminder. A lot of you came home too. A lot of us came home too. Aren't you glad that you serve the true and living God? Hallelujah. Come on, He's a healer. He's a deliverer. Hallelujah. He will set you free. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. You know me. I want to ride that vein right there until Jesus comes right there. Woo! God is awesome. There's no one. No one like our God. So we say that to say to you today, to say to anybody watching, God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we could ask or think. According to the power that is within us. And so with the power of the Holy Ghost, we know that God is able to do anything for you. There's not a problem too big that He can't solve. There's not a problem too small that He won't solve. If it plagues you, it plagues Him. If you care about it, He cares about it. Come on, somebody, is your faith high yet? Hallelujah. Come on, I feel like God is able to do anything today. It doesn't matter if you have marital issues, relationship issues, financial issues, if you have health issues, whatever issues. If you ain't got no shoes, God's able to do it. Amen. Praise God. Well, let me just, don't get me started. You better just stop right there. Praise God. So, we do have some prayer requests that need to be mentioned today. And one of them is Sister Susan's brother-in-law, Dennis, is still in need of a miracle. But as we know, God is able to do it. And also, we need to pray for the families of Linda Herring. She went on to be with the Lord, I believe it was yesterday, in the last couple of days. Also, the family of Gary Milligan and Martha Halcomb, we need to pray for them. They are not walking this earth anymore, but we have a promise of a better and a brighter day. Thank you, Jesus. So so we need to pray for those families for help, for comfort, and for the assistance from God to continue on. Of course, as you know, we do. We've got names on the screens, and they will roll. And there's a lot of people that need prayer. A lot of situations, of course. There's still that COVID devil running around the country, the world, that's trying to wreak havoc. So we need to pray against that. And so our faith is high. We know that God is able. And so why don't we go ahead and take these knees before the Lord. If you have a need in this house, I want you to raise your hand right now. Come on, if you have a need. If that person is in your family, why don't you reach over and grab them by the hand if it's appropriate and that person's in your family. If not, why don't we just reach our hands toward the screen, towards these people, and let's pray. My God, right now, in the powerful name of Jesus, we know that you are able, God, and that there is nothing impossible with you. And all things are possible through the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. And God, we lay claim and lay hold upon these exceeding great and precious promises that you've given to us for help, for strength, for comfort, for deliverance, God, for freedom in this house. Hallelujah. We pray for all of those who are afflicted in their body, God. We pray that you would heal them right now. Those who are struggling in their mind, God, with mental issues, God, we pray for them right now. We bind the spirit of hell that would try to hinder them, would try to keep them pressed down and oppressed and depressed. Oh, my God, in the powerful name of Jesus, we claim healing, power, and mercy in this house. Hallelujah. We plead the blood. Hallelujah. We plead the blood in this house, Lord, over every family that's lost a loved one. God, whether there be anybody in this world, God, looking online right now, I pray that you would reach down right there where they are. Let them feel the power that we feel in this house today. My God, like a lightning bolt, I pray that you would just zap them, God, with your power, with your presence. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody, give him some praise in this house. Well, say, I got a praise. Whoa, wait a minute.
Something happens when I call your name. 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 Mountains move when I call.
Breakthrough's coming, right? We break through when we call your name. Now, let me tell you a little something. We have someone here today that was not in this house physically, but was watching online and prayed back through to the power of the Holy Ghost. Sister Corsi, it's so good to see you back in the house of God. It don't matter where you are, change can be loose when we call his name. Come on, let's do it right now in Jesus' name.
We break through when I call your name. We break through when we call your name. We break through when we call your name.
Yeah.
Something happens when I call your name. We break through when I call your name. We break through when I call your name.
We break through
when I call your name.
Something happens.
Let's spend a moment here this morning giving God the praise that is due unto his name. Hallelujah. Let's give him praise. Let's give him praise. Hallelujah. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We are so glad for Sister Corsi. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. She not only came back to God and prayed back through to the Holy Ghost last Sunday, but she is an answer to my prayers. Hallelujah. Because I've been praying this whole time we've been doing online service. I said, God, I don't know if I'm helping anybody. I don't know if we're helping anybody by doing this online service, because we never hear. You know, you hardly ever hear from anybody. Praise God. So, hallelujah. Amen. I just begin to pray, God. Amen. Are we helping anybody? And then Sister Corsi, amen, pray back through to the Holy Ghost, watching the service last Sunday morning. Hallelujah. We're helping somebody. Hallelujah. We're helping somebody this morning. Hallelujah. Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah. Turn around and give somebody a big thumbs up this morning. Good to see you all. Brother Clint's already mentioned the crowd is growing. Amen. The congregation is growing. There's more and more people showing up at the house of God, and we are so grateful, amen, for your attendance in the house of the Lord here today. Hallelujah. Thank you for coming. God bless you. You can be seated this morning. Praise God. Hallelujah. Just good to be in the house of God. Good to be in the house of God. And I think that pretty soon now, we're going to start back with our Wednesday night services, and hallelujah. But between now and then, I want to go ahead and announce that not this coming Wednesday, but the following Wednesday, amen, Brother Thomas and Sister Leah is going to have an online children's church service. Praise God. Not this coming Wednesday, but the next Wednesday. Amen. We had them scheduled for this coming Wednesday, but, well, he's got to go take lessons how to help his wife deliver a baby. Praise God. And we don't want him to miss out with that, do we? We want him to learn everything that he can. Praise God. So he can be a help to her. Amen. When this baby's time comes to be born. Praise God. Hallelujah. I remember those days, and I remember those lessons. And I remember I must have not have done too good. It was about time my wife started having that baby. She grabbed a handful of my hair. Hallelujah. Amen. I thought she was going to yank it all out, but praise God, she didn't do that. Amen. And thank God we had three healthy babies. Hallelujah. And they're all in the house of God, all except one. She's in Tennessee this morning. But we're glad to have our children in the house of God this morning. Good to see you and your children and all those that are coming back, our visitors. Amen. Our visitors around here. Praise God. Good to see you. Good to see Megan. Hallelujah. Good to see Megan all the way from Kentucky. Praise God with us this morning. A little, amen, Myron's little grandson there. I saw him a minute ago. And he's all dressed up looking like a little man. Hallelujah. Just show everybody my goodness. Ain't that a good-looking little boy? Hallelujah. Good-looking little boy. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank God for the blessings of God on his children, right? Hallelujah. Amen. He said it would prosper us and let us be in health even if our soul prospers. Part of that prosperity, amen, is bringing children into the world. Hallelujah. Amen. This morning, well, I'll be glad when we can get back to normal, regular church services. And hallelujah, we'll get the choir up here to sing and all those other things that we normally do. But we're not quite there yet. Hallelujah. And so we're just going to do the best we can with what we've got. Thinking about the first song that they sung this morning. Hallelujah. And how that in that song we sung repeatedly we sung the words, and again I say, rejoice in the Lord always. And then we would sing that verse, again I say, rejoice in the Lord always. Again I say, rejoice in the Lord always. Hallelujah. What would make a songwriter, amen, want us to repeat the words of that song over and over and over and over and over again. Praise God. You know what made that songwriter make us want to repeat those words? Again, I say, rejoice in the Lord always, over and over and over again, because we are so forgetful sometimes. Amen. To rejoice in the Lord in all things, in all times, in all situations of life. Praise God. Hallelujah. It's easy to rejoice when things are going our way. It's easy to rejoice when everything is fine and well. Amen. With us. Praise God. It gets a little tougher, a little harder to rejoice when things are not seemingly going our way, and we're facing hardships and situations and sicknesses and diseases that are adversely working against us. Praise God. But if we'll just do like the song said, rejoice in the Lord always. Hallelujah. We'll find out that God was just as close to us, or probably even closer to us through the hard times than he is through the good times. Praise God. Let's give the Lord a great big hand clap of praise. Let's give our song leaders, our musicians, amen. Let's give them all a hand clap of appreciation. This has been a big adjustment, amen, for the whole church. Praise God. We've got parents sitting in the sanctuary right now this morning with their children sitting by their side, wishing those kids were back in Sunday school. Hallelujah. Amen. Just hang on. Hang on. Hopefully we'll be able to have Sunday school again before long. Praise God. Don't give up on God. Don't give up on the church. Hallelujah. Amen. It's going to get good again. It's good today. I'm feeling the presence of God today. It don't have to get good again. It's good today. Hallelujah. Amen. We got every reason in the, amen, in the world to rejoice this morning. Praise God. Hallelujah. My wife and I decided to get away for a few days to try to get our heads cleared and try to get the cobwebs out. Man, you deal with so many different things for so long, you just got to get away a few days. But on the evening that we left, we went by to see her Aunt Martha. She was talking. She was seemingly upbeat to us. You know, she was talking and carrying on and just having a good conversation with us as we got ready to leave town. So we kind of felt comfortable in going ahead leaving town because we thought, well, you know, we know her time's going to come. We know it's, you know, not far down the road, but we felt like she was going to hang on, you know, a little while longer. Praise God. And then on the first night that we were there, about 11:30 that night, we got a phone call that her Aunt Martha had passed away. Hallelujah. So, and then the next day we got a phone call that Gary, my cousin, passed away. Praise God. So, hallelujah. Sometimes when you try to get away, amen, and get your head clear and get things kind of cleared up in your mind and heart, praise God, sometimes those issues of life still follow you wherever you go. Praise God. I don't know how many trips that we have had to call off. We would be going somewhere for a few days. We get a phone call, have to turn right around in the middle of the trip and come back. Praise God. Hallelujah. I remember that I had went on a hunting trip. My wife had went on a cruise with her sister. And right in the middle of that trip, you know, I knew my mom was sick, but I didn't think she was going to pass away in the next week. So I went on a hunting trip. My wife went on a cruise. And right in the middle of the cruise and the hunting trip, I got a phone call that my mom had turned for the worse. So I got in a car and drove all night long to get back home to be with my mom in her last hours of her life. My wife, amen, got on a plane from the cruise ship and flew back to be with my mom also in her last hours of her life. Praise God. We never regret those decisions to turn around in the middle of a trip or to get back home as quickly as we could in the middle of a trip. We've never regretted those things. Life happens, praise God. And sometimes it happens when we don't want it to happen. But nevertheless, we got to respond to the things that, hallelujah, are necessary at the moment. Praise God. So, hallelujah. I appreciate the fact that, amen, that we at least got back to be at Gary's funeral and was able to speak at his funeral as well Saturday. Praise God. Or Friday evening. I'm sorry. Friday evening. If you got your Bibles this morning, I want us to turn to Jeremiah chapter 31. Hallelujah. Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 29 through 31. And in those days they shall say no more. The fathers have eaten a sour grape, and the children's teeth are set on edge. But everyone shall die for his own iniquity, every man that eateth the sour grape. His teeth shall be set on edge. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Praise God. You can be seated. But I want to pick up this message in Ezekiel. Amen. Because Ezekiel, amen, took up the subject that Jeremiah had spoken about there in Jeremiah chapter 31. In Ezekiel chapter 18 this morning, reading, amen, verses 1 through 4. The Bible says here, and I want you to take notice to what it says. The word of the Lord came unto me again, saying, what mean ye that ye use this proverb concerning the land of Israel, saying, the fathers have eaten sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge? What mean ye by saying that proverb? What mean ye by mentioning that in times like this? He said, as I live, saith the Lord, or the Lord God, ye shall not have occasion any more to use this proverb in Israel. Behold, all souls are mine, and as the soul of the Father, so also the Son, the soul of the Son is mine. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. What is this proverb that God is going to strip away from them? What is this proverb that God is saying to them? You're no longer going to be able to use this proverb in Israel. Praise God. I want to preach to you, amen, this morning just simply from this thought, amen. A proverb, say it with me, a proverb of the wicked. A proverb of the wicked. Amen. The proverb that God is referring to here and is mentioned here in Jeremiah 31 and Ezekiel chapter 18, amen, is not a God-inspired proverb. Praise God. Anybody, amen, any group of people, any nation of people, amen, can create their own proverbs. Praise God. A proverb is simply just a short memorial saying, amen, that states a point of view. That's all a proverb is. Now, I know that there is a book found in your Bible, amen, that is called the Proverbs. Hallelujah. Amen. But that doesn't mean, amen, that Solomon was the only man that ever wrote a proverb. Hallelujah. The thing about Solomon's proverbs was that they were inspired of God. Amen. They were inspired of the Holy Ghost. That's why they ended up in the Word of God. Amen. But every proverb that you've ever heard and every proverb that I've ever heard was not inspired, amen, by the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. A proverb is a proverb. It's just a short, memorable saying. They're easy to remember. Praise God. It states a point of view. An English proverb is something like this, or could go something like this. Two wrongs don't make a right. Now, how many of us have ever used that proverb? Amen. Why do we use that proverb? Because there is a ring of truth to that proverb. Two wrongs don't make a right. Amen. But that proverb didn't make it into the Word of God, right? Hallelujah. Amen. When in Rome, do as the Romans do is another proverb. When in Rome, do as the Romans do. Praise God. They take that from what Paul wrote. Amen. But yet, amen, that proverb is not found, amen, in the Word of God. Here's one that I even heard yesterday sitting around our dinner table. I believe my son made mention of this. Amen. They said the squeaky wheel gets the grease. Did you say that yesterday, Brian? I thought you did. Amen. The squeaky wheel gets the grease. Well, that's a proverb. Hallelujah. Amen. And certainly that's the truth. If you got a wagon or if you got a wheel on a wheelbarrow or a lawnmower or whatever, and that thing goes to squealing and squeaking, amen, that's going to be the first thing that you grease, amen, when you grease anything. Praise God. Hallelujah. Here's another English proverb. The pen is mightier than the sword. Amen. It's not necessarily the proverb has to be bad. It's not necessarily the proverb has to be, you know, something that we shouldn't use. We all use, amen, proverbs like that on a daily basis. Hallelujah. The problem with proverbs is that, amen, they are easy to remember, and they can easily shape an opinion about life, amen, whether that opinion is right or wrong. A proverb is easy to remember. Amen. And being that it is so easy to remember, it can easily shape an opinion about life. Amen. Whether that opinion about life is right or wrong. Somebody hang on with me this morning, all right? Hallelujah. Here's another proverb. God helps those that help themselves. Hallelujah. God helps those that helps themselves. Sounds good. That sounds good. And that sounds right, praise God, and we can take principles of the Word of God, amen, to try to prove that proverb, praise God, hallelujah, God helps those that helps himself. I'm not saying it's a bad proverb, hallelujah, amen, but it is not altogether true. It is a half-truth, amen, it is not altogether true, amen. God also helps those who cannot help themselves. God doesn't just help those that help themselves. Amen. God also helps those who cannot help themselves. Hallelujah. And that part is just as true as the other part. Hallelujah. So some of our proverbs are built upon half-truths. Amen. Some of them make just good common sense. Amen. Some of them we use in everyday life. Hallelujah. Amen. But God helps those that help themselves, that cannot help themselves. I have found out that God will allow me, amen, to do for myself whatever I can do for myself. If I can do it, God lets me do it. Now, I'm not taking any praise and honor and glory away from God by saying that I can do things myself, amen, because I got sense enough to know, amen, that if God blesses me with a strong, healthy body, amen, a sound mind, and with intelligence enough, amen, to go about life and do things for myself, I'm not saying that I'm doing those things in and of myself, amen. I'm still giving God praise for the strength and the ability and the knowledge to do things, but if I can do it myself, God does allow me to do it, right? Amen. If I'm driving down the road and I got my hands on the steering wheel, you know, God ain't going to come into the car and say, hey, take your hands off that steering wheel, let me drive a while. I mean, I know God can drive a car. There's songs written about God taking the wheel. I feel like maybe God's taken the wheel of my vehicle a few times, took it out, snatched it out of my hands, put it in his hands. Amen. Deal with the vehicle, what needed to be done to save my life. Hallelujah. I'm not taking anything away from God. God can drive a car. Amen. God can drive a plane. God can fly a plane. God can, amen, do whatever God decides to do. But if I can do it on a general basis, God lets me do what I can do. Right? Amen. Another parable is practice makes perfect. Well, as much as some of us practice sins, then we should have perfected sin, right? As bad as some of us were, we went out every day to sin. Amen. We intended to sin. We tried to sin. We lived to sin. Hallelujah. It looks like we would have perfected sin. Amen. But as a sinner, I was a lousy sinner. I was a lousy sinner. I wonder if anybody else here was a lousy sinner. I never did perfect sin. Amen. I never could feel good about sinning. Amen. Somehow when I was born, God put a conscience in my mind. Amen. And I would wake up with the intentions of going out and sin. I'd go out and do my best to sin. Amen. The best way that I knew how to sin, I'd come home, and my God, my conscience would bug me all night long. So I never perfected sin. I was a lousy sinner. I don't know how great of a Christian I am. Well, y'all looking at me like I just dropped the watermelon. Amen. I've been serving God 41 years. I don't feel perfect. Amen. I've been living with God 41 years. You'd think at 41 years I'd have everything all right. Everything, you know, I do everything just right, act just right, talk just right. Hallelujah. I do everything in a perfect manner after 41 years, but I ain't there yet. I hope that's not saying that I'm a lousy Christian. Hallelujah. But I do wake up every morning and say, God, you got to help me through this day. Hallelujah. If I'm going to come out the other end of this day, amen, and be successful as a child of God, then God, you got to help me. God, you got to help me. I don't want to be a lousy Christian. I was a lousy sinner. Hallelujah. I want to get this thing fixed, and I want to get it right. I want to do it right. Hallelujah. Somewhere along the journey, I want God to perfect me. We use this proverb often. All good things must come to an end. We interpret that saying, amen, or at least young people interpret that saying, amen, that it means that all fun things must come to an end. All good things must come to an end. The young people hear that, well, all fun things must come to an end. Praise God. That's not what it's saying. All good things must come to an end. Well, I take it that that parable is not completely true, because I feel like serving God is a good thing. Hallelujah. And I don't want to stop serving God. I don't want my service to God to come to an end. So, you know, it may fit some needs and may fit some situations. Hallelujah. Amen. But it don't fit every situation. The proverb in Jeremiah and Ezekiel is actually a proverb of the wicked. Amen. It was created and used by men and women who had made up their minds that they did not like God, neither did they like the ways of God. And this proverb that they were using against God, amen, gave voice to their disapproval of God's ways. It gave voice to their disapproval of God's ways. Amen. The fathers have eaten sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set at edge. What in the name of God are they talking about? I'll tell you exactly what they're talking about. They're saying in that Proverbs that our fathers have committed the sins, and we, the children, are having to pay for their sins. Our fathers committed the sins, but God, you are making their children responsible for their sins. And they didn't like that. Amen. The fact of the matter is they didn't understand the Word of God. Amen. They didn't understand what the Scripture said about those things. Hallelujah. So they conceived this idea, amen, in their own evil hearts and minds to throw up at God and throw back at God, amen, when things were not going well in their lives. Hallelujah. Amen. Where did they get this idea? Amen. I'm telling you, it came from a misunderstanding of the Scriptures. I just said something very important there. Amen. Where in the name of God do some of these people out here in the world, in the Christian world, get some of their ideas from? A lot of their ideas come from a misconception, a misunderstanding of what the Scriptures have to say. Hallelujah. In Exodus chapter 20, verse 1 through 6, praise God, I'll just read it off the screen. And God spake all of these words, saying, I am the Lord thy God, and have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above or that is in the earth beneath or that is in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow thyself down to them nor serve them, for I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation. Is that scripture really saying that God is going to hold responsible children for the sins of their fathers? Oh, we got to finish reading the verse of scripture. Amen. Visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me. The next verse of scripture, if you would. And showing, let's read the rest of the scriptures. Amen. And showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. Hallelujah. What is God going to do? Amen. If those generations of children, amen, grow up to hate God just like their fathers hated God, amen, then the iniquities of their fathers would pass down because of their hatred of God. But if they love him, amen, if they love him, if they keep his commandments, amen, God is going to be merciful, amen, unto those children. Hallelujah. Amen. I've got sense enough to know here this morning that a parent who does not choose to serve God can affect their children. Amen. Children are led through their lives, amen, by their parents. Hallelujah. Amen. And an ungodly parent can affect, amen, up to four generations. An ungodly parent can affect up to four generations. Now, I've been to a lot of funerals. Amen. I've been to a lot of funerals where the deceased, amen, had grandchildren, great-grandchildren, and even great-great-grandchildren. Hallelujah. But I've been to only probably a handful, maybe not even a handful. I can't even remember. But I have been to several funerals where in the obituary it listed that the deceased, amen, had great, great, great grandchildren. Maybe some of you have seen that as well. Praise God. It's a very rare occasion. I even Googled it to make sure, amen, that I was remembering correctly. And there are people that have lived long enough to have great, great, great grandchildren. Most of us, amen, you know, we'll never get there, I assume. Amen. Because most people never get to the great, great, great generation. The great, 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 great generation would be five generations. You got the generation that's involved, their children, their grandchildren, their great grandchildren, their great, great grandchildren. Amen. But if you go to great, great, great grandchildren, you go to another generation that most people will never be influenced by an ungodly parent or an ungodly great, great, great grandparent. Amen. Because they will never live long enough to affect that child. Hallelujah. Amen. But an ungodly parent can affect up to four generations. Children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, and great-great-grandchildren, but not great-great-great-grandchildren, of them that hate me. Hallelujah. Children can learn to hate God at home. Amen. Children can learn to hate God at home around ungodly parents. They can get a sour taste in their mouth about church, about the Word of God. Amen. All these other things at home. We all know that. Hallelujah. But that's not the whole story. Amen. An ungodly parent by that scripture can affect four generations. That's not the whole story. Verse 6 says, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. That lets me know, amen, that every child didn't follow in the footsteps of their moms and dads. Amen. If a child could break out from, amen, an ungodly parent and live for God, God would not bring the iniquities of that parent on that child. Hallelujah. Amen. And just like hating God can be learned through parents, loving God can also be learned through parents. Just like hating God can be learned through a parent. Amen. Loving God can be learned through a parent. Praise God. Hallelujah. And this same truth is repeated Amen. What is written in Exodus there is repeated again. Hallelujah. In Exodus chapter 34, in Numbers chapter 14, I'm not going to read them all. But again, in Deuteronomy chapter 5 and verse 9, let's read it. It'll basically say the same thing. But I want you to see that it is not only said one time, it is repeated again and again and again throughout, amen, the writings of Moses there. Praise God. Deuteronomy 5 and verse 9 says, "Thou shalt not bow down thyself unto them, nor serve them, for I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me." Again, hallelujah. If the parents, amen, cause the children to hate God, then the iniquities are just going to pass down from generation to generation. Praise God. Hallelujah. This parable of the wicked, amen, derived from a disdain about God's word, a misunderstanding of God's word. Whoever came up with a parable, praise God, hallelujah, that our fathers have tasted sour grapes and now the children's teeth are set on edge, hallelujah. Whoever, amen, came across that parable, hallelujah, amen, had a disdain for God. They misunderstood what the scripture was saying. They actually twisted the truth. They perverted the truth so that they could say God is unjust. The same way people are doing today. Amen. People are coming against the word of God, coming against the truth of God. Amen. I guess so, just so they can have a platform to stand up somewhere. Amen. Before a group of people and say, God is an unjust God. God's not an unjust God. They were lying on him back then. They're still lying on him today. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. These people are liars. Hallelujah, amen. They don't know the truth. They're ever learning but never coming to the knowledge of the truth. They're liars. Hallelujah. How many times does the scripture say of a various king, amen, that ruled over Israel? How many times have you read it, amen, it's just reading through, amen, those books that cover all the lives of the kings, and it says, and he walked in the sins of his father, which he had done before him, and his heart was not perfect before the Lord. Amen. That statement is made, or a similar, very similar statement of that is made, amen, repeatedly about, amen, the wicked kings that rose up to rule over Israel. Praise God, their hearts were not perfect, amen, before the Lord. They walked in the sins, amen, of their fathers. Hallelujah. But in 2 Kings chapter 22, verses 1, 2, and 3. The Bible says, Josiah was 8 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 31 years in Jerusalem. And his mother's name was Jedidiah, amen, the daughter of Adoniah of Bozkoth. And he did that which was, how in the name of God did this guy do this? How did he pull this off? Amen. He was 8 years old when he started ruling. And at 8 years old, he did that which was right in the sight of God or the Lord and walked in all of the way of David, his father, and turned not aside to the right hand nor to the left. Verse 3. And it came to pass in the 18th year of King Josiah. Did I want that one read? I guess I did. Amen. But verse 1 and 2 at least. Amen. Let me say something about that verse of scripture. Hallelujah. And not that the Bible is contradicting itself, but David was not Josiah's father. He was not his birth father. Hallelujah. He was an ancestor of Josiah, but he was not Josiah's father. Hallelujah. Ammon was Josiah's father. And Manasseh, amen, was Josiah's grandfather. Hallelujah. Amen. And we know that Ammon didn't do right in the sight of God. Manasseh was one of the most evil, wicked kings that Israel ever had until right at the end of his life, till he got his heart right with God. Amen. He didn't get his heart right with God long enough to have, amen, any influence on Josiah whatsoever. But right at the end, it does appear that Manasseh got things fixed up between him and God. But before them, amen, then he was one of the most wicked kings that Israel had ever had. So Josiah, amen, didn't really have, amen, much of a role model inside of his house. He had a father that wouldn't follow God. He looked at a grandfather, amen, that wouldn't serve God. So, amen, Josiah said, I'm not following in the footsteps of my dad. I'm not following in the footsteps of my granddad. I think I'll just look back farther in my ancestry, and I think I'll walk in the ways of David. I'll let David be my father. I'll let David be my spiritual father. Amen. Even though he's not in my life whatsoever, I'll look to him and let him be my father. Amen. 2 Kings, amen, verse 23, or chapter 23 and verse 25. Praise God. Are words, amen, that were written about Josiah. And like unto him, who? Josiah. Was there no king before him that turned to the Lord with all of his heart and with all of his soul and with all of his might according to all of the law of Moses? Neither after him arose there any like him. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, if anybody got it right, Josiah got it right. Amen. But he had to look beyond his own household to get it right. Amen. And he had to choose righteousness over ungodliness. He had to choose righteousness. And the example of righteousness in King David, amen, he said, I'm going to walk in his footsteps. I'm here to tell somebody this morning, no, children don't have to reap for their parents' sins. No, you're not going to have to pay for your parents' sins. Hallelujah. That's a parable of the wicked. That's a parable of the ungodly. Amen. That's a slap, or, you know, they were trying to slap God in the face, saying, hey, we know what your word says. The iniquities of the fathers are going to be handed down for, you know, three or four generations there. Hallelujah. But they didn't read the rest of the story, right? Hallelujah. The parable of the wicked is wrong. Praise God. Amen. If a child that is raised by ungodly parents takes a different route, amen, then the parable of the wicked is wrong. It always has been wrong, and it always will be wrong. Somebody said that Jeremiah contradicted himself. Amen, in Jeremiah chapter 32 and verse 18 and 19. Somebody said, amen, I read the commentary. Amen, they said Jeremiah said one thing in this chapter, and then he turns around and says something different in another chapter. Praise God. Let's read it, Jeremiah 32. Thou showest loving kindness unto thousands. And recompenses the iniquity of the fathers into the bosom of their children after them. The great and mighty God, the Lord of hosts is his name. Great in counsel and mighty in work. For thine eyes are open unto all of the ways of the sons of men. See, they didn't read the second verse. To give everyone according to his ways and according to the fruit of his doing. Yeah, parents can affect their kids. Parents can affect their children in a negative way. Amen. And this stuff can go through generation after generation. Hatred for God, disdain for the church. Hallelujah. A hatred for the ministry of God. All those things can be passed along. Hallelujah. Amen. But if somewhere along life's journey, that child or that young person or, amen, that adult, even if they make it to adult years before they make that choice. Hallelujah. Amen. If they make up their mind, I'm going to live for God. I'm going to serve God. They won't have to pay for their parents. Amen. Sins. Jeremiah didn't contradict himself. You got to read it all. Somebody say, you got to read it all. Hallelujah. And now, at this point of the message, we know what Ezekiel chapter 18, verses 1 through 4 says, because I've already read it to you. Amen. But I want to read, amen, the rest of the verses of Scripture. Let's read start in verse 6. Oh, no, I'm not going to read verse 6 through 17. Well, yeah, I am. Let's read verse 5. I'm backing up. Let's read verse 5. Then I'm going to skip verse 6 through 17 because I don't want you to be here all day. Amen. But if a man be just and do that which is lawful and right. Now, he just got through saying about the iniquities of the fathers being passed down. But then in verse 5 it says, but if a man be just and do that which is lawful and right. And then he spends verse 6 through verse 17 of Ezekiel there, amen, talking about a man who is righteous. Praise God. Let's read verse 18. As for his father, now he just talked about all those verses of scripture, if a man be righteous, he does everything right. This is how I'm going to handle the righteous man. As for his father, because he cruelly oppressed, spoiled his brother by violence, and did that which is not good among his people, lo, even he shall die in his iniquity. Amen. Let's read verse 19. Why? Amen. Yet you say, why doth not the son bear the iniquity of the father? When the son hath done that which is lawful and right, and hath kept all of my statutes and hath done them, he shall surely live. You know what they're asking here? Amen. They said, why? Lord, we thought your word said that the iniquity of the father was going to be passed down to the sons and their sons and their sons. What changed? What changed? Why, God, are you coming to us with this change? Hallelujah. Why are not the iniquities of the fathers now not going to be handed down to other generations? Hallelujah. What changed, God? We've always heard the fathers have eaten sour grapes and the children's teeth are set on edge. And God is saying to them, nothing has changed. Nothing has changed. Amen. You just heard and you just accepted a perverted idea about me. You know, the Bible does say God's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Hallelujah. And God is basically saying to his people, and nothing changed. It's been that way from the beginning. Hallelujah. Amen. If a child grows up to serve God and is righteous, I will treat them, amen, in a right way because of their righteousness. Amen. But if they allow themselves to be influenced by ungodly parents, then the iniquity of the parents will pass along to them. Amen. Just as it always is with sin. Nothing has changed. You just heard it wrong. Nothing has changed. You just perverted the idea, amen, about me. Hallelujah. Amen. Here's how it is and always has been. I'm going to pick up, read verse 20, reading down. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. The son shall not bear the iniquity of the father, neither shall the father bear the iniquity of the son. The righteousness of the righteous shall be upon him, and the wickedness of the wicked shall be upon him. But if the wicked will turn from all of his sins that he hath committed and keep all of my statutes and do that which is lawful and right, he shall surely live and not die. It's been that way from the beginning, people. Amen. And his transgressions that he hath committed, amen, they shall not be mentioned unto him. In his righteousness that he hath done, he shall live. Have I any pleasure at all that the wicked should die, saith the Lord God, and not that he should return from his ways and live? But when the righteous turn away from his righteousness, it's the same way. God is a just God. Amen. If a wicked man turns, amen, away from his wickedness and turns to God, God's going to treat him in a certain way. If a righteous man turns from his righteousness back to wickedness, guess what? God is going to treat him as a wicked man. But when the righteous turneth away from his righteousness and committeth iniquity and doeth according to all of the abominations that the wicked man doeth, shall he live? All of his righteousness that he hath done shall not be mentioned. In his trespass that he has trespassed, and in his sin that he hath sinned, in them shall he die. That kind of blows the once saved, always saved idea up, don't it? If the righteousness turn from their righteousness and become wicked, in their sin shall they die. Yet, go ahead. Yet you say, the way of the Lord is not equal. God's an unjust God. They say, yet you say the way of the Lord is not equal. Hear now, O house of Israel, is not my way equal and not your ways unequal? See, they've been treating God wrong. They've been treating the word of God wrong. They've been preaching the wrong concept, amen, about God. Hallelujah. When a righteous man turneth away from his righteousness and committeth iniquity and dieth in them, for his iniquity that he hath done shall he die. Again, when the wicked man turneth away from his wickedness that he hath committed and doeth that which is lawful and right, he shall save his soul alive. Because he considereth and turneth away from all of his transgressions that he hath committed, he shall surely live, he shall not die. Yet saith the house of Israel, the way of the Lord is not equal. O house of Israel, are not my ways equal and your ways unequal? Therefore, I will judge you, O house of Israel, everyone according to his ways. Everybody is going to be judged according to their own ways. Amen, saith the Lord God. Repent and turn yourselves from all of your transgressions, so iniquity shall not be your ruin. He's still reaching out to them. He's still trying to show mercy to them. Cast away from you all of your transgressions, whereby ye have transgressed, and make you a new heart and a new spirit. For why will you die, O house of Israel? For I have no pleasure in the death of him that died, saith the Lord God. Wherefore, turn yourselves and live ye. Turn yourselves and live ye. Praise God. That's exactly how it is, and that's exactly how it always was, amen, but it was a perverted mind of a perverted, wicked people, amen, that tried to build a concept about God that was totally wrong. God has never taken pleasure in people dying in their wickedness, hallelujah, amen. He's never taken pleasure in people dying lost and undone without him. God does not take pleasure today in people dying lost. Amen. God is reaching out to us every day. Amen. Giving us the opportunity to turn. To turn from our wickedness. To turn from our sins. But you know what? After all that God, all that Jeremiah said to them and Ezekiel said to them through the power of the Holy Ghost and the unction of the Holy Ghost. Amen. In John chapter 9, verse 1, 2, and 3. They had a hard time giving up that concept of a son paying for the sins of his fathers. And Jesus passed by and saw a man which was blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, saying, Master, this guy's blind. And they stopped Jesus and said, who did the sin here, Lord? Who did the sin? Who committed the sin that caused this little guy to be blind? Was it this man or his parents? Was it the sins of his parents that caused him to be blind? They still hanging on to that stupid concept that children had to pay for the iniquities of their fathers and parents. They're still hanging on to it. Verse 3 says, Jesus answered, neither has this man. He just blew their bubble. He just popped their little balloon there. He said, neither has this man sinned nor his parents. It wasn't sin that caused the blindness. God allowed the blindness, amen, that the works of God should be made manifest in him. See, you and I are not God. Amen. The ways of God are so much higher than our ways. We'll never get God figured out. Here's a man that God says, nobody's sin, amen, that caused this young man's blindness. Amen. He's blind. Amen. That the power of God may be manifest in him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. What God is basically saying to these same Jewish people is that you've got to stop all this nonsense. Amen. You got to once and for all escape from this nonsense. Amen. The kids have got to pay for their parents' sins. Amen. How did he do it? He said, some things happen that the glory of God may be made manifest. Amen. I know that I have faced some things in life. Amen. That every time I face things in life, amen, I go down the list. And I ask myself the question and I ask God the question. God, did I fall short of your glory? God, did I fall prey to a sin somewhere that is yet unknown to me? Hallelujah. What happened, God? Did I sin? What happened, God? Did I do something wrong? I guess probably some of y'all do the same thing. When something starts going wrong, something gets wrong, something goes wrong, you just, what did I do wrong? It's human nature. We do that. Praise God. Probably not a bad thing. It's probably not a bad thing that we start searching our heart, because things do happen to awaken us to things in us that we may not be aware of. Praise God. So by doing that, amen, if you do have an issue somewhere, then God can reveal it to you. You can get it right. Praise God. Hallelujah. But I've never went down that list and said, God, what did my parents do wrong? What did my mom and daddy do that caused this to come upon me? I never went down that route. Hallelujah. Amen. Because I've never believed that nonsense. Hallelujah. Amen. If something's happening in me, praise God, I want to examine myself and make sure that I didn't do anything right. And can I actually say that there have been times, amen, that after I went down the list and asked God all the questions, amen, that he never answered none of those questions, as if to say, you didn't sin. And it wasn't sin that caused this issue. But this issue has come upon you that the glory of God may be revealed in you. You don't have to sin to have things go wrong. We got to get this stuff out of our head. You ain't got to sin for things to go wrong. Now, sin does cause things to go wrong, but it ain't always sin that causes things to go wrong. Amen. Look at Job, and I'm not even going to go preach about Job. Look at Job. Hallelujah. He was a righteous man. He was a godly man. He's an upright man. But I ain't got time to go into all that. Jesus was saying to these folks, listen, you got to get away from this nonsense. Somebody listen to me today, and I'll try to close here in just a short little brief moment, or two or three, or four or five. You may be here today in this sanctuary, or there may be somebody listening online to this service. And you're sitting here and you're thinking about, well, preacher's kind of right. You know, my mom and dad, They didn't really ever go to church. They didn't really take me to church. They didn't really ever take me to Sunday school. You know, I had parents that just really wouldn't turn on to church for whatever reason. Amen. So your parents may have not have ever taken you to church. And your parents may have not ever even mentioned God to you as a child. And they may never, ever even took you to Sunday school. They may have never sat down on the couch in the evening when you was a child and read those little Bible story books that we always love to read to our children. About Noah and the Ark, Daniel in the lion's den, three Hebrew boys, hallelujah, and all those other things, Zacchaeus and the sycamore tree. All those little Bible story books that we love to read to our kids. But your parents may have never read your Bible storybook. They could have even possibly been atheist. And they may have even influenced your way of thinking to some degree. You may have went through childhood, through your teenage years, and you may be an adult sitting here this morning or watching online this morning, and those parents that never took you to church, never took you to Sunday school, never read a Bible to you, a Bible story, amen, never mentioned God in the house or whatever, hallelujah, all you ever heard was cussing and swearing and fussing and fighting, amen, that went on in your house, I don't know, hallelujah, or your mom and dad may have got along perfectly well in their atheistic ways. You may have never heard your mom and dad raise a voice to each other, hallelujah, but if they didn't take you to church, and they didn't take you to Sunday school, and didn't read any Bible story books to you, or, amen, mention God to you, I'm sure, amen, that they had some influence on your life. And I'm sure they had some influence on the way that you think, even today. But my hope today, amen, is to help you understand, amen, that you don't have to go down the same path, amen, that your mom and dad went down. Hallelujah. Amen. You don't have to travel, amen, that same route that they traveled. Hallelujah. Amen. You don't have to be lost, and you don't have to go to hell. Amen. This morning, and I'm not saying, amen, that your parents who are lost this morning, amen, are going to go to hell. But I better explain that. Somebody say, explain that, preacher. Hallelujah. Amen. If you make up your mind this morning, you're going to get in church and you're going to serve God. Amen. You can turn around and be the positive influence. Amen. That your mom and dad never was towards you. Amen. You can turn the thing around and be a positive influence on them. And you can be the vessel, amen, that wins that mom and dad to the house of God. So I'm not putting your mom and dad in hell this morning, amen, just because they never took you to church. That can all change, amen, through you. It can all change through you. You can change the whole family tree. You can change the whole family atmosphere. Hallelujah. If you'll make up your mind this morning, I'm not going to be lost. I'm not going to go to hell. Hallelujah. I'm going to get things right between me and God. Hallelujah. If the Bible says, if the ungodly turn from their ways, amen, that God will meet them and offer to them, amen, the same mercy, amen, that they need, amen, just like we needed it ourselves. God don't withhold mercy from anybody that will turn their face toward him and their heart toward him and, amen, and reach out to him. God makes allowances, amen, for a person, amen, to see their mistakes that they've made and the sins that they have committed, amen, and God will allow that person to repent. Hallelujah. You may have been the biggest devil that ever walked down the street. I don't mean you got to go to hell this morning. Amen. That don't mean you got to go to hell this morning. Hallelujah. Amen. You may have been the black sheep in your family, so to speak. You were the hellion of the bunch, if I can use that word. I hope I didn't just cuss. I'll look it up after and find out. Hallelujah. You may be the kid that your mom and dad looked at and said, why did we keep having kids? At least the firstborns in here don't have to worry about that. Some of the little kids and later kids. God allows for us to repent and make an about face and to turn in a different direction. Repentance is crying out to God. Repentance is confessing your sins. Repentance is asking God to forgive you of your sins. And I'm here to tell you, amen, if you fall on your face before God and you start crying out to God, amen, with contrite spirit and a broken heart, the Bible says God cannot turn, amen, that away. God will listen, amen, when you make up your mind, amen, that you're going to pray, that you're going to talk to God, that you're going to confess your sins, amen, that you're going to ask him, amen, to be merciful towards you. I'm telling you, God's ears perks up, amen, and he will focus on you. He will look in your direction. Hallelujah. And I'm going to tell you, God does forgive sins. Amen. But God's got a plan. Amen. And God's plan not only, amen, consists of God forgiving sins, but God wipes away sin. God wipes the sin slate clean. Well, preacher, tell me about that. Praise God. Hallelujah. Well, after you repent of your sins, amen, God's plan is, amen, for you to be baptized in water in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Acts 2 and 38 says, for, amen, the remission of your sins, which means, amen, the removal of your sins. When I stand before the throne of God, I want to, and you want to, send all of your sins ahead of you and not have any sins come up behind you when you stand before the throne of God. And the only way that I know how to do that, amen, is for you to repent, amen, and get baptized in water in the name of Jesus, get those sins remitted, amen, and receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost, the gift, amen, of everlasting eternal life today. Hallelujah. Amen. That don't mean you can repent one time and never repent again. Hallelujah. Repentance is not just for, amen, a sinner that's never known God. Repentance is for the born again that finds himself in a mess sometimes. You got to get back on your face and cry out to God and repent again. Send that sin, amen, on ahead of you. Praise God. Words have meaning. Amen. Acts chapter 2 and verse 38 says, "And ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost." Praise God. Peter said to them, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of your sins." That's the only thing that will get your sins remitted. "And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost." Words have meaning. Amen. Words have meaning here this morning. Amen. When God promises you the Holy Ghost, amen, he is saying, amen, that he will fill you with the Holy Ghost when you repent and get baptized. Just stay with me just a couple more minutes. If y'all want to come on up and get a song ready. Here's the deal breaker. Here's the deal breaker. And tying this in with the rest of my message. Here's the deal breaker. Or it was to me when I read it. It was to me when it was pointed out to me back many, many, many years ago. Verse 39 says, he promised you the Holy Ghost because you repented and got baptized in Jesus' name, right? But then he says, the promise is unto you. Words have meaning, right? The promise is unto you and to your children. And to all that are afar off, as many as the Lord our God shall call. When you repent, get baptized in water in Jesus' name, get filled with the Holy Ghost, guess what? Amen. You just became a positive influence on your children. You just became a positive influence on your parents. You just became a positive influence on your nieces and nephews, uncles and aunts and cousins. Hallelujah. Amen. You just became, amen, you just gave them an opportunity. Hallelujah. That was the deal breaker, amen, for me. If I do this, if I repent and if I get baptized in water in Jesus' name, I receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost, amen, then I can give my children and my grandchildren a greater chance at knowing God and receiving the same promise that I received. Hallelujah. Oh, God, somebody needs to hear me. I don't know which road you're on. I don't know which route you're headed. I don't know which path you're on this morning. Hallelujah. Amen. But if you're on that broad road that leads to destruction, you need to get on another road this morning. You need to get on another path this morning. There's a straight and narrow way. Straight and narrow road. Hallelujah. That leads to life everlasting. That's the road you want to be walking on, especially when you draw that last breath. And I'm not preaching deathbed repentance. Hallelujah. But you want to be living for God when you take that last breath here on this planet. Praise God. Here's what I saw when I read those scriptures for the first time. Not only could I change my own future, but the future of my whole family could be changed as well. Thank God my kids are in church here today. Thank God my God. Grandchildren that are in church today, repented, baptized, filled with the Holy Ghost. Praise God. I'm not saying we're all where we need to be. Amen. We're all still being worked on every day. Hallelujah. Thank God that for those that are surrendering their lives to God and learning how to surrender their lives to God more every day. The truth remains the same throughout the Word of God. Each individual is responsible for their own choices, whether those choices are good or whether those choices are bad. Each individual is responsible for their own choices. I'm not going to be saved, and I'm not going to be lost because of what you do. What you do is not going to affect my eternity. What you do is not going to affect my my spending time in heaven with the Lord or my going to the hot place. It ain't going to affect me whatsoever. But this morning, if God is offering you an opportunity to fix all of your wrongs, and that's exactly what I feel like God is doing this morning. I feel like God is speaking to somebody that may have been using parents and grandparents and other family members. You may have been using those people for an excuse that you can't escape from drugs, or that you can't escape from alcohol, or that you can't stop lying. You know, I know that some of you had moms and dads that were alcoholics and drug addicts, and if their mouth was open, they were telling lies. I've heard people say of other people, they're a liar just like their daddy was a liar. They're an alcoholic just like their daddy was an alcoholic. They're, you know, listen, folks, we can't use our parents and grandparents, and we can't use those folks as an excuse to not get right with God. It ain't gonna hold water. That bucket's full of holes. That bucket is full of holes. That bucket of excuses is full of holes. Hallelujah. You're not gonna get up there and stand before the Lord and say, well, my daddy took me down that road. My mama took me down that road. God's gonna look at you then and say, didn't you hear that preacher at Higher Praise Tabernacle that got up there and told you, amen, that you didn't have to be bound by the sins of your mom and dad. Amen, that you didn't have to be bound by the sins of your parents and generations before you. Amen, that gave you an opportunity, amen, to make it right with God, to get right with God, and amen, to get on the right path with God. Amen, which is exactly what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to present somebody here, amen, with an opportunity to change the way that you're living, change the path that you're on. Amen, quit blaming mom and dad and others for the sins that you just don't seem to be able to break loose from. Amen, if you'll come to God and you'll repent and give your heart to God, let me tell you something, the Spirit of God will come on the scene. And we sing a song around here about chains breaking. Hallelujah, chains breaking. Amen. When you start repenting of your sins and crying out to God, amen, all of a sudden those chains will start being loose. Amen. Those chains will start breaking. Amen. The power and the anointing of the Spirit of God, amen, will start breaking you loose from all of those chains. Hallelujah. I've often wondered through this COVID virus, saying, what are we going to do if somebody comes to the altar? I tell you what I'm going to do if somebody comes to the altar. I'm going to get in that altar with them, pray for them. I'm not going to stand up here and let them pray by themselves. Hallelujah. You may be scared. You may, amen, be dismissed. You can do whatever you want to do. But if somebody comes to this altar this morning, amen, and it looks like they mean business with God, there ought to be two or three or four or five people around here willing. Hey, let me go ahead and say it. There ought to be some of us around here that's willing to get COVID-19 again. Amen. To pray somebody through. Amen. To the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. I'll take a chance at it. I'll take a chance at it. Amen. I'll take a chance at it. Let them come. Hallelujah, let him come. We'll pray with him. Let him come. We'll seek God with you. Oh, my God, I'm tired of trying to have church in a backward way. Hallelujah. I'm tired of trying to see God move, amen, while we're moving out of the sanctuary. God, how are you going to move if we're all leaving? I thank God nobody left me in that altar by myself. I thank God that nobody left me in that altar by myself when I fell and on my knees to pray. If you'll take the challenge this morning, come up here and pray. We'll get some folks. We'll recruit some folks to come up here and pray with you. If God is offering you an opportunity to fix all of your wrongs, get all of your sin business fixed, how can you walk away from that? How can you keep putting that off over and over and over again? I don't understand. People sit in here Sunday after Sunday, Wednesday after Wednesday. They hear sermon after sermon. They keep putting things off. Why do we put it off? Why don't we get it fixed today? Why don't we get these things fixed today? How many times does God have to reach for you? How many times does the preacher have to reach for you? It's not like it's hard to live for God. I'm not asking you to do something hard. Come live for God. That's hard to do, but come live for God. That ain't what I'm saying. Amen. I'll be the first one to tell you it's a good life living for the Lord. I didn't even know how to live until I came to God. I didn't know how to live. I didn't know what joy was. I didn't know what peace was. I didn't know what love was until I came to God. But when you decide or make up your mind to surrender your life to God, you will find joy like you've never found before. You'll find peace like you've never found before. You'll find happiness like you never found before. It's a good life living with God. I came to my office this morning. I got up at 5:30 at home, took a shower. Well, really, 5:15. I got the shower. Left the house about 5:40. Came to the church, and I sat in my office, and I said, God, I got 100 notebooks over here. I've got a file cabinet that's just slap full of sermons. I got books with messages in them on my bookcase. I said, God, I don't want to turn. I don't want to go to any of those sermons that I preached and just warm them up for churches. Well, I want something from heaven. I want something for today, right now. I want something for today, right now. Hallelujah. Amen. And God immediately took me to Jeremiah chapter 31 in that parable. Our fathers have eaten sour grapes, and now the children's teeth are on edge. That was a proverb of the wicked back then. It is still a proverb of the wicked today. Hallelujah. If you want to get right with God, take the challenge while they sing the song. Come to the front of the church. Amen. Lift your hand to God. Bow in the altar. Whatever you feel like you need to do to get next to God and close to God. Hallelujah. Amen. But God, I feel that the Holy Ghost is reaching for somebody. Amen. God, I feel that the Holy Ghost is reaching. Amen. And this could very well be your last opportunity. Life is short. It's like a vapor. It comes up early in the morning, soon vanishes away. None of us are promised tomorrow. None of us are promised that we're going to get home today. Amen. None of us are promised another breath. So in light of that truth, here's your opportunity. You can go to heaven. You can be saved. You can fix it today. Hallelujah. Today is fix it day. Sister Jessie got some things fixed up between her and God. Prayed back through to the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. What a marvelous thing that was and is. But I don't feel like she's the only one. I don't feel like she's the only one. I'm not saying that she was doing a whole lot of things wrong. I don't know what she was doing, but she got it right. Prayed back through. Close your eyes If I can't get you to come to the front, can I get you to at least close your eyes? Can I get you to lift your hand to God from wherever you're standing in this congregation? Can I get you to lift your hands this morning? Hallelujah. Could I ask you to pray? Amen. God, help me. God, help me this morning, God. I need you, God. God, help me this morning, God. I need you. I need you, God. I need you. Amen. To take the reins of my heart. If you're watching online this morning, amen, why don't you fall on your knees and pray? If you're watching, amen, this service from wherever you are, why don't you find a place to pray right now? Oh, call on God. He's a merciful God. If any man, if any woman, if any boy or girl will turn from their unrighteousness, I'll be right there. I'll be right there. I'll be right there. I'll be right there. I'll be there with arms full of mercy and arms full of grace. Hallelujah.
Because I never want to go back to my own life. I need you, Lord.
Come on, somebody. Do you need God today?
Words can say
more, God. realizes that we need God more today than we did yesterday. We need God more today than we did yesterday. We need God more this year than we did last year. We needed God last year, but man, things are getting a little weird. Things are getting a little strange. Things are getting a little crazy in this world. Hallelujah. And as the world gets crazier, I realize I need God more and more. I need God more and more. Hallelujah. Oh, God. Touch her this morning. Feel this heart again with a love and appreciation for you. God, feel this heart again. Hallelujah. Lord, restore her faith. Restore her confidence in you, oh, God. Give her all that she needs here today, God. Make her a vessel of honor, God. Make her a vessel of honor, God, today. Hallelujah. Make us all vessels of honor today, God. Vessels of honor. Oh, Jesus. Let's sing it one more time. I sure feel the drawing power of the Holy Ghost. I feel the touch of the Lord still in this place. Hallelujah. I feel like the arms of God is wanting to reach around this whole congregation right now. Hallelujah. And comfort us and help us. Hallelujah. Come on. What you're feeling right now is the arms.
More than yesterday, I
Section right here will be dismissed.